David Jeremiah told me this story. It was this construction crew. They were building this great big building. There were some construction workers up on near the top of it working, and one of them fell off about 100 foot. And the building actually fell into the, they had a bunch of insulation there at the bottom of the building getting ready to put in the building. And he actually fell in that stuff. So all the workers rushed down to see how to do it. He's laying there face down and all this insulation instead of work. Call an ambulance. They call an ambulance. Well, they get the ambulance over there and the rescue workers come out there to see about the guy. They can't get the ambulance right close by, so they're going to have to poke this guy out of there. But they check him out and everything. His eyes closed. He's breathing. His heart's working and everything, but he ain't said a word. He hadn't opened his eyes or anything. He only opened over on his back. So they knew they were going to have to come to the dude out to get him to the ambulance. They were going to have to put him out on the floor. And so they got him checked out and everything, got him loaded up on the board, and lifted him up. And immediately the guy's eyes opened up and he began to speak. And you won't never miss what the first words were that come out of his mouth. Anybody? Don't drop me. The title of this sermon is, what are you doing with God's word? And we all know what God's word is. It's right here. God's holy word. I can take this Bible right here and hand it over to Kate. I can open it up right in her lap. Put it in her lap for her to read. She took the Bible. She didn't want me to drop it on her foot. But I can't make her read. I can't make her read. It's like a horse somebody drove around for years and years, dragging it to water. I've only heard the story a million times. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. God is not going to make you read His Word or study His Word. He's not going to let you come to church and hear His word from the preacher. He's just not going to do it. That's all on you, every bit of it. Whether you want to study God's word or not, whether you want to be a Christian or not, you can't blame anybody in this world if you're not a Christian but yourself. You can't blame anybody if you don't come to church on Sunday morning and hear the preacher. This is your choice whether you want to serve the Lord. I heard a lot of y'all this morning when I asked you if you love the Lord, you said amen. Well, I pray that you do. And the ones of you that don't know the Lord, I pray that you will get to know the Lord before it's too late. Because there will be a day and a time when it will be too late for you to come to the Lord. We're going to start off this morning first, and we're going to bump around a little bit. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17. 2 Timothy 3, verse 16 and 17. Verse 16, this is in the NIV Bible. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for everyday work. All right. This is saying that all words in the Bible are God-breathed. In other words, this is not some kind of story or some kind of myth that somebody's made up. have done it by inspiration of God. Everything that's in the Bible is true, factual, and I believe every word. And if you have questions about the Bible being true, then take my word for it. Everything that's in this Bible is true, and God breathed, and it was given to us to structure our lives behind, to read and study and know how we should act, how we should carry our lives, what we need to be doing on a day-by-day basis as we go through life, whether we're in Walmart, whether we're at work on the job, wherever we may be, whether we're at play or whatever, our lives need to be structured, and we need to obey the Word of God in everything we do and everywhere we are. It's also it's the standard that we use to test everything else. Somebody, say you don't read your Bible every day, and somebody comes up and gives you their version of what they think the Bible means. Well, how do you know if they're telling you the truth? How do you know if they're not leading you down the wrong road if you're not in the Bible? I know there's people all around, all over the world, even Christians that come to read their Bible, but you may not understand how important it is to stay in the Word of God. I like getting my day started, getting up in the morning before I go to work, and read something out. Some days it may be 3 or 4 verses, some days it may be a whole chapter. I got enough time, I might read a whole book if it's not a long book. I mean, but you need to get the Word of God in your mind where that's what you're thinking about every day, and that the devil preaches. See, the old devil, he don't want you reading about it because he don't want you to know how you're supposed to act. He wants you to act like he acts. He wants you to do things that he wants. He don't never take a place. He don't never go on vacation. He never gives up. He knows all of your weaknesses. He knows everything that gets you going. When you're driving down the road, trust him. He knows everything to do to make you angry at somebody else driving. I mean, he knows exactly how to do it. You're in a hurry to get somewhere, and I'm always in a hurry. And there's this whoever in front of you driving, let's say, 54 miles an hour and 55 miles speed limit. They could be going 1 more mile an hour, and that way I could get there. See? And then you get them, they're going on down the road, you're following 2 miles. On a 2-lane highway, a double yellow line in the middle of the road, so that's it, you stop. Well, they get on over there, and there's an intersection up here, and they turn off. Oh, man, that's good. But there's a gas station right over here, and there's another dude that pulls right out in front of him, and he's running 53. So you're not even better off. That's just a little scenario of how the devil works. He gets, give it to you. But seriously, y'all, there's a lot of information in the Bible that you really need to know. And if you don't get into the Bible and read it and study it, how are you going to know the love of God? How are you going to know how much God wants you? Sure. Sunday morning, come in, Brother Jason preaching sermon on God's love. Sure, you can get it that way. Everything that I've looked over for this sermon, I'm pretty sure, and all of you are too, or would be, if I tell you, Brother Jason preaching. Pretty much, basically, a whole lot of stuff since I think he's been here. He preached about, but we're going to talk about that a little bit if I can, if I don't forget. Because I'm nervous. But where you hear that Sunday, he preached. Right? He preached it on Sunday night or Wednesday night. You hear it? You hear it? How are you going to know what it takes to become a Christian unless somebody tells you? Are you reading the Bible? Are you sure about your salvation if you're a Christian? How are you going to know? How are you going to be sure that you're saved if you don't read about it? Several verses that guarantee our salvation. The most important to me, the most inspiring, the most verse that tells us how much God loves us is one verse located in John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish but have eternal life. What kind of other guarantee would you need that your salvation is guaranteed other than the Word of God telling you that your salvation is guaranteed? That means that you're taken away. How much more, or how, where else can you find anywhere other than the Bible that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son? That's how much God loved. If you don't read that in the Bible, and you don't go to church on Sunday morning, how are you going to know that? Take the encounter of, I don't want to call it a story, but it's not a story, it's an account of David and Goliath. Everybody know the story of David and Goliath? This big 10 foot, well, he's actually 9 foot 9 inches tall. That's pretty close to 10 foot. And how David conquered this dude with a sling and a stone. That is an original, true account of part of the life of David. That's not true. But it's a great read. So it's all in the, it's in the 1 Samuel. Chapter 17, y'all want to look over. I'm just going to read a couple of verses if I have any time. But I'm going to tell you a little bit of the account that you wouldn't necessarily ever even know about if you didn't read your Bible. Going to be verses 45 and 46. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the you can know it on God. I have a friend. Here we go, David and Goliath. David is this little bitty dude, a little bitty young man, little bitty young guy. This giant, the whole army of Israel is fearful of. He comes out and they're on one side of the valley, and the Philistines are on the other side of the valley, and this great big giant comes out every morning and defies the army of Israel. Old David, he said, sheep herder for his dad. He's over there taking care of the sheep, and he goes home to got his two other brothers who were fighting in the Israel army. The whole army is afraid of this one guy, one man. They're all scared of him. And David hears about this. Hears people talking. Hears some of the soldiers talking about how fearful they are and what the king will do for whoever killed him. He gets all excited. Little old me guy, like me. He gets all excited. Well, I'm going to take care of this dude. I ain't scared of him. And here's why. Verse 45 says, David said to the Philistine, you come to me, you come against me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give your carcasses to the Philistine army, to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. Do you know why David was able to do this? Do you know why he was able to conquer this big tall dude with this little bit of rock and this long shot? Because he stood behind God. God did all the work. He had the faith. All he had to do was have faith that God was going to take care of whatever he come up with. You know, we all have devices in our life. Things that frighten us, things we're afraid of, things we're scared to get. Do we look to God to see if he's there with us? Do we know that we in our Bibles and love God enough and understand God's word and his love for us and what he'll do for us? Well enough to know that he's going to take care of anything we've ever been through or going to go through? Do we understand that? Have y'all all not gotten through everything that gone on in your lives in the past, just like I have? I'm in this way now. I mean, I'm not just talking to y'all. I'm talking to me. He's talking to me, too. Do y'all not realize that God takes care of everything? David knew this. All these other big soldiers that had been trained to fight. He hadn't even been trained except to kill a bear and a lion, trying to get to sleep. But all these soldiers were frightened of this dude because he was so big. There's no problem anywhere we ever going to face that God can't get us through. You wouldn't know that about this story if you didn't read the Bible. Imagine what we could all do as a church and a community and a world, a nation, a state, a country. If just the Christian people, us, me, we, all of us, we'd read and study our Bible enough every day to know that when we go out into the world, we're supposed to be spreading news of Jesus Christ. Not just walking around here acting like the world's acting. Telling no ugly, nasty jokes and just wanting to fit in so bad. You know, when you're a kid, when you're in school, you want to fit in so bad with everybody else. And look like everybody else because you don't want to be laughed and mocked at. The Bible specifically says, when you serve the Lord, you want to be persecuted. We the same way as adults. We are the same way. We don't want to be laughed at. We don't want to be mocked. We're going to keep our mouth. We also know the Great Commission. We do know that. And we're still frightened. In Ephesians 2:4-5. Ephesians 2:4-5. Up over there. Ephesians 2:4-5. This year is also telling us about how much God loves us. And because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Everybody in here, you're saved by grace. Not nothing to do about it. The Bible said there's not even one good. You're only saved by what Jesus Christ has done. We all should know it. People that are not saved, I would say you're saved by what? On 10 now, and 10 is you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord. That's not a Lord. That is your Lord. And believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, with your mouth that you confess and you are saved. So you don't have to do a little dance. All you have to do is believe in God, believe in Jesus, and let him be the Lord. Very simple. I know a lot of people that don't know the Lord and serve the Lord and are not Christians don't read the Bible very much. You hear people all the time, I do. Even Christians read the Bible. I had a gentleman two or three, said he had quit reading the Bible. Somebody that left. He quit going to church. He couldn't get nothing out of it. And he quit reading his Bible. Because he couldn't understand. Being made righteous don't happen in the blink of an eye. Being made righteous is a lifelong journey that you receive by number one, loving the Lord, doing what this is. Not doing what this says, then it's very hard. I'm not saying it's impossible, I'm saying it's very hard. And no, nobody, I don't personally don't believe, this is my own personal belief, take it for what it says. You might feel differently, but I don't believe there's anybody that completely understands everything. As you grow, and first of all, you got to hunger. You got to be hungry for the word of God. He's not going to make you be hungry for him. You got to do it. This is on you. You got to do it yourself. If you want to live, if you want to know more and understand more about the Bible, live by what you do understand, and then you become able to understand more of what you want to understand in the Bible. I really intended for this message this morning, my intention may not be God, and that's fine. my intention was to encourage you to read the Bible. Encourage you to study with it. Learn more about the Lord. That's my intention. Any conviction that you are under right now, that's on you. I'll tell you one, I know this. Because whatever you're doing, right or wrong, God ain't gonna make you that bad. Whatever you're doing that's right or wrong, that's giving you conviction right now, it's not good. It's not going by the word of God. Whatever that may be. That's on you. It's also, it's a book that it's just, you can use yourself every time you open it up. You may get stuff out of this or that or the other verse today to help you with something that's going on in your life or something you need heard from. Conviction, whatever it may be that day. Or, get something and make it out of the same person. It just uses itself to me every time you pick it up and turn it on. It's just, I got another question for you that I want to look at. This one's in Ephesians, also chapter 3. This one's in this here is about, it's also talking about God's love. God's praise has you being rooted and established in love, this doesn't seem to be accurate, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide, how long, how high, how deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses that you may be filled with the measure of the fullness of God. Back up to where 19 starts, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge. That tells you. You wouldn't know this unless you read your Bible regularly or hear it from me. We don't have enough knowledge. We can't comprehend enough knowledge in our head to understand how big and how deep and how wide the love of God is. I mean, it's greater than we can ever understand or imagine. God's love for us is that great. And I hope you're not saved today. I hope you're listening to this, because you need to know that God loves you, and you also need to know that God loves you more than anything. God loves you more than anybody ever. God does. You need to know that. This devil that's always promising you stuff and telling you stuff and getting you to do stuff you shouldn't be doing, he don't love you. He could care less. He has one goal. That one goal is to destroy you. But he does. Hang in here with me. I'm about to get down. Don't hang on. This is more about this is more about God's love. 1 Corinthians 13. 1 the reason. Love is patient. Love is kind. But now before I start, this is these are God's attributes. Y'all know we serve a patient God. Y'all know we serve a merciful God. These are attributes, though, that are supposed to be in place. But we're supposed to be doing, we're dealing with people. You know, our neighbors that we're supposed to love, as we love ourselves. The first commandment, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and all your strength. Second one is, love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's supposed to be done. Can you love everything?
Sure.
Here we go. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always prepares. No, love never fails. That's what fails. This book here, then, this instruction book, is God gave us speak by speaking and teach by doing. Act out what we believe that we read in the Bible. Act it out. Not just tell somebody how many times a month you go to church. How much Bible you read? I read the Bible through in 1 year, read it through 5 years. We're going to live our lives in a way that would mirror Jesus. This whole book is about Jesus. Every bit of it. Every bit of it. Probably should have said this in the beginning. But I did. I have a nerve to do it. But if you pick up your Bible and you decide you want to read it one day, start at the beginning. What is the beginning? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That means everything in heaven, everything in the earth. That means me, you, everything else. God created. We own everything. We don't own anything. Everything we have or have been blessed with comes from God. Everything. The devil don't give you anything that's trouble. Everything that we own, our car, our home, our jobs. I know you all love your job. God has blessed us. Everything. Get up this morning. Crawled out of your bed. God stood you up. He owns everything. Everything is his. And when it's all said and done, everything is going to be fine up. We're going to be gone off to heaven. People that will not listen to God's word are not going to heaven. There's only one other place you can go. The Bible says this is the last one. You saw it moving you around a lot, but my hope is, well, my thought is that I hope they've been here before. But anyway. still doubting, if you're not a Christian, if you're still doubting whether you need to be saved or not, let me tell you. Going to heaven, going to hell is real. You're going one way or the other. Everybody, not just everybody, the whole world, everybody that's alive is either going one day, going to heaven, or they're going to hell. Everybody. There ain't no exception. You're either on the right side or you're on the wrong side. This two verses right here says it all. Philippians 2:10-11. Here we go. Are you ready? At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven. That's already done. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Everybody, whether you want to or not, you can do it now and go to heaven. If you do it in the end and have accepted Jesus Christ, hear me now. If you do it later when you're made to do it, you're going to do it. But if you do it when you're made to do this, it ain't going to help you one bit. You're not going. You're going. You're not going. Today is the day of salvation. Not tomorrow. Not the next day. Like I said, I hope this encourages you to read the Bible more. I need to read one. Reading more of the Bible is not going to hurt you one bit. All it can do is make it. You want to make a decision on Jesus Christ, if you want to pray at the altar, you got something on your heart you want to talk about? There's plenty of people in here that know the Lord, and closer to the Lord, way closer than I. Grab a hold of them and talk to them. Pray to God that He'll have mercy on you. He's the only one.